And we're back. This is your RPG chick. Still here in Hearthsong. We're about to go up the into the Celestial Sapling. And we have a quest to do there. Oh, that's about Haravius. Is it even a quest or is it a task? Right. The sealed missive. The monk in Elmshore, with his dying breath, gave us this missive to deliver on his behalf to the brothers of his order. We have not opened it. We've kept his final request, kept our word there, so. We have inspected the, whatever, the casing, but we have not opened it. So. Let's go up. I think there's another way up if you talk to the ogre. He asks you if you want to go up, and you can say yes. I'm assuming it just goes to the loading screen at that point. Be cool if we had some animation of us, you know, being launched up into the tree. You see a problem, I throw it over the side. Alright. As usual, I've noticed in this area there are a number of spots to examine which we cannot examine.
Sure.
And I hate that because I want to explore everything, you know me. Dear Wooden, everywhere I look, I see some tribesmen giving me the stink eye. They sure are an unwelcoming bunch. That ogre keeps looking at me like I urinated on some ruins. I'm guessing these are people with histories to read. Frightened villager. Can I buy passage to the Republic's maybe? This man looks up sharply as you approach, eyes going wide. You! You're the one! The one he's looking for! He sets down his wine. You killed Lord Radric. Keep it down, idiot. No, you don't understand. It didn't work. I'm one of the guards of the keep. Was one of the guards. He killed most of them. The ones you didn't. Pretty sure I left no one alive. I remember killing all those people. Kolsk, he didn't last very long. Nothing but empty air, him. Nice enough to work for. I mean, much nicer. But that didn't help him when Radric came back. Gods, the screaming. His eyes. It was like he was burning inside. He shudders. He says he's come back to lead us, like before. Says he's going to kill you for what you've done. I told him I'd find you, give you his challenge. Do it all honorable, that sort of thing. He let me go, and I kept on running as far as my coin let me. Ha! Funny, me running into you anyhow. I guess we're gonna have to fight Radric again. Oh, man. We got new things to do, and we're getting old things coming back after us. Number 4 is funny. And what's your stake in all this? What? Nothing. I don't mean to go back there as long as I live. I figured I'd find work here in Twin Elms somewhere, even if I have to guard some hut dwellers' goats or something. Until then, I plan to drink until I don't remember any of what happened. Good luck to you. There's something awful out there howling after your blood. Huh. That's an interesting development. Seems that something stirs in that great keep yet. It might be the work of a new usurper after the throne or mere superstition. Either way, it may be worth investigation. I encountered a former guard from Gilded Vale. He claims that Lord Radric himself has returned to the keep, despite his having died at my hand. Apparently Radric seeks vengeance upon me for having ended his life and has issued a challenge. It may be worth investigating in any case. Well, that's pretty interesting. You keep away from me. I don't want to be around if he decides to come looking for you. Alright, let's hear these histories and then we'll advance further in. Nicia Silversmith. You see a woman of fire, twisting and dancing through a horde of skeletal enemies. Arrows stream through the air, but with a twist of her wrist. Rhymes. She sends a sheet of fire careening toward the offending archers, incinerating all in its path. She screams, concentration lost, as a pike pierces her leg and forces her to the ground. As the skeletons advance, she begins to burn brighter, hotter, chanting something between gritted teeth. She flickers out for a moment, the fire contracting, and then waves of white fire explode from her, destroying everything in their path. The only thing left is the sound of her panting and a pained grunt as she twists the pike from her leg and plants it in the ground to support herself as she gets up. She turns to leave, limping slowly towards the door, but something stops her. A guttural, inhuman whisper weaves its way through the air as a final figure rises into the air before her, claiming her, beckoning. Against her will, she is drawn forward, nose filled with the reek of death and dust. Her face is glazed, unresponsive. She falls at the creature's feet, and something in her comes awake. Eyes burning, she stands once more and stretches out a hand, stroking the skeleton's ivory cheek, turning bone to cinder and ash. She stands there long after it is gone. Ash is blowing in some spectral breeze. Something had laid claim to her, and this was not the end of it.
Mm-hmm.
Ishguinin. You see a man, his eyes hidden behind horn-like growths, his face broken in despair. His frenetic pacing distracts another man, who curses and begins his chant again. The body of a woman lies on the table below, all slack white skin and punctured chest and rounded belly. Life left her body days ago, but the man chants over her husk, spell after oddly rolling spell, until sweat burns through his lashes, onto his chin. For a moment her exhale eyes open, cold and void. The pacing ceases. Her body falls back to the table with a crack, unmoving, and the broken man weeps tears of black from his misshapen face. The men leave. Time passes. The body screams until morning.
That's pretty horrible.
You know, I like when we exit these little histories, how the sound comes roaring back like reality again. That's pretty cool. I don't think I've ever mentioned that. The unusual stone pulses with warmth. Are they burning Adra? How do the Estermorian drink as much as they do and accomplish, well, anything? Or is it heated up Adra? I don't think you can burn stone. I love how the Valian folk women always crouch down when they talk to an Orlan. Puts the goods at eye level. I guess that is a good perspective. Dear Wooden. There's an armed Valian woman lingering near one of the guest rooms. What's she waiting for? Echo! Yep, urinated on ruins. The tribes are so spiteful of outsiders, yet trading with us has improved their lives a great deal. That's interesting, because we're in a tree. We hear bird sounds and tavern or inn sounds. Camille Witchmere. Guys think something is really hilarious. You see a man browsing through some goods at a stall near the edge of a busy marketplace. The elf, or this elf, is standing against the side of a building nearby, seeming to look off into the distance. Although she gives the appearance of calmness, even nonchalance, her eyes are locked on the man across the street from her. Her gaze never wavers, never leaves him. He finishes browsing and wanders down the street, looking from side to side. She waits for him to almost get lost in the crowd, then pushes away from the wall and follows him, always keeping him in sight, but never getting close enough to be seen. Eventually, he turns down a side street, walking to an opulent residence with a private entrance. She approaches cautiously, watching him as he undoes a series of mystical locks on the door. When he finishes and the door swings open, she steps forward. At the sound, he turns to face her. She looks him in the eyes, and there is an almost imperceptible flash in her gaze, and suddenly he is standing rigid, his eyes glazed. She smiles, extends her hand in greeting, and looks into his house. He takes her hand like someone in a trance, blank face, never registering recognition. I can't wait to see all the goods you're going to give me, she says conversationally, and guides him into the house, glancing over her shoulder to ensure no one is watching them. Okay, and who's that? Camille Witchmere? Talk to them, right? When they say random things, I'll just look again. You see but one face of your Glanfath. There is no sight finer than the great trees of Elm's Reach. And ditto. Valian woman. You know what isn't hidden in these Ingwithan ruins? Proper drink recipes. I should pace myself. The guards get ornery when patrons get too drunk and lively. Hail, Eletharian Haggard Shoes.
Hail, traveler.
He hailed me right back. A middle-aged elven man stands behind the counter of the inn. He has a warm, open face and smiles pleasantly in greeting as you approach. Welcome, welcome. I am always glad to see a new face. Take a seat where you like, my friend. It seems to me you've walked a long road. All are welcome here, and those with interesting stories most welcome of all. Tell me about this place. Of course, his face brightens. I founded the inn many years ago, but in many ways its tale begins much earlier. It was while I was returning from a long journey south that I first heard the story of the tree upon which this inn rests. Hundreds of years ago, a strange event occurred. The sky was troubled that night, with many stars falling across the sky, and one of those same stars began to plummet. Instead, towards Eora. It fell here, striking a young tree and burying itself within it, like a fiery heart. But the tree survived, and over the years it grew, and grew, and grew, twice as big as its fellows in half the time, until it reached the size you see now, and grew no more. Hearing the tale, I knew I must find the truth, and you see it there. He gestures toward the large stone at the center of the room. Oh, around the tree's heart I built this inn to welcome all travelers who might look upon it. Canna looks over the stone and grins. A fine story. I'll carry that one home. I'm always glad to see a new face. And you've said this before, right? Who are you? My name is Eletharian. They call me Haggard Shoes, for all the walking I used to do, and all the boots I wore down. But those days are well behind me. My eyes have seen a great deal, and now my ears get their fill from the travelers who come through here. Kenna says, a fine way to spend one's days, to my thinking. What do you have for sale? Of course, we offer meals and some supplies. Have a look. Ooh, what's a spirit spiral? Oh wait, I just wanted to... +5% melee damage grants Whisper of Treason 3 per rest. These bracers are made from a coiled strip of bronze. Though tarnished and beaten almost beyond usefulness, they glow with a soft violet light. Of the many experiments of the ancient Ingwithans, some involved infusing equipment with soul essence. The hammered patterns on these bracers suggest they were originally pieces of animat armor. But among the fragments of essence swirling inside, you detect not only the focused energy of an animat, but also the essence of the elven cipher who created the bracers and tried to enhance them with a fragment of his own soul. Huh. What was Whisper of Treason? Oh. I don't want to buy that, at least not right now. Farmer's Spread? +1 move speed, +2 might for 300 seconds. Dear wooden farmers, especially in Tenfurths, make heavy use of this egg-based spread for their workday meals. The Ten Firthers, renowned for their unflappable nature and rustic stoicism, are often the butt of jokes involving their humble food. The more good-natured jokes feature Ten Firthers accidentally putting the whole eggshell in the spread and eating it all without complaint. Mean-spirited jokes involve the Ten Firthers impassively eating stones, chicken feathers, nails, and other appalling substances that somehow got mixed up in the spread.
We've seen this, the pie and the beef loaf thing. Okay, it's interesting. We are full of camping supplies, indeed. Let's go this way, then. Or is there anything else to look at? No. Have a moment? I would like a word with you. Who are you?
Greetings.
Cwineth. I'm guessing. A slender woman in dusty leathers locks eyes with you. It's good to see someone from more civilized lands around here. Her unkempt hair sprouts in wavy black tufts. Despite the fine features that sculpt her face, a cleft chin completes her boyish appearance. I'm learning firsthand the many shortcomings of Glamfellen hospitality. Her gloved hands come to rest on the pommel of a long estoc, cinched low on her hip. I can almost forgive the hostility toward outsiders, but the temperate taverns and these water-drowned drinks? Inexcusable. I hope I don't seem too forward, but I need to help my friends, and you look like the right person for the job. A sly smile carves a dimple on her cheek. I didn't drink. Which is to say, you're not Glamfellen, making you the closest thing I've got to an ally in this paranoid land. She gives you a coquettish sideways glance. And allies, well, they help each other, do they not? Who are you? The woman pats the dust off her leggings and gives you an exaggerated curtsy. Where did I leave my ambassadorial manners? She flashes a mocking smile. I am Cwineth. Pleasure to meet you. She lifts an eyebrow with a blushing smirk. For the time being, though, I'm just another Estremor minding her own business. What help do you need? My friends have drawn some unwanted attention. She looks to both sides, scanning for uninvited visitors. Glamfellen scouts, and not just any mob of local zealots, the Fangs. She pauses to let the name settle in the air. The Fangs are a brutal, relentless bunch, eager to make an example of troublesome outsiders. As for why I need your help? Her smile widens as she speaks. I need someone to warn the expedition that trouble is coming, and I need someone ready to fight, if it comes to that. She taps her hand on the pommel of her estoc. With any luck, we'll reach my friends before the Fangs do, but if not, the Fangs have a reputation to uphold, so this might require spilling blood. Yeah, one is a good point. Two is a very good point. What did your friends do to draw the attention of the Fangs? Just setting foot in Ir Glamfellen is a good way to offend the tribes. I don't know how they picked up our trail. I suspect one of the newer scouts didn't cover his tracks well enough. When I spotted the Fangs, they were retracting a path the expedition had taken days before. Why aren't you with the rest of your friends? Why not warn them yourself? Her posture stiffens at the question. It was my turn to handle Fort Patrol. I spotted the Fangs on my trek back to camp. I knew that rejoining the main group would risk leading the enemy right back to the expedition. I know the woods and I know how to stay quiet, but I don't want to stake my friends' lives on my ability to sneak past expert hunters like the Fangs. If they noticed me warning my friends, we'd have been overrun. Cwineth tilts her head to the side and points to you with a grin. But if they notice me and some reinforcements, like, say, you, well, at least then we can scare them off or put up a good fight. Tell me more about your expedition. I like to think we're on a mission of reclamation. Cwineth darts a shrewd smile. It is said that our armies left behind many valuables in their hasty retreat from Ir Glamfellen at the end of the War of Black Trees. So the way I see it, we're simply gathering up what our ancestors left behind. I doubt the Glamfellens agree with me on this, she adds with a dimple grin. My expedition set out from Defiance Bay, heading directly east to cross into Glamfellen lands. I split off once we arrived at the Bale, the natural frontier between our nations. The plan was for me to keep my eyes on the Glamfellens while the main group scoured the target area. For days we eluded them. She walks her fingers over the back of her leather glove, leaving a trail on its dusty surface. But the Fangs got wise to our presence. Your friends are trespassing. By local custom, they're criminals. Cwineth frowns and blinks at you several times. You'll forgive me if I'm not sympathetic with face painters and their barbaric laws. I'm not pretending that what we're doing is noble. I just don't believe trespassing is a crime that warrants execution. Fine, I'll help you warn the expedition. Her eyes... Cwineth smiles... Okay, that's a typo. Threw me off. She smiles with an overt display of dimples. Excellent. I knew I could count on you. She leans in and whispers. Assuming the Fangs didn't already get them, my friends should now be at or around the Pilgrim's Trail in the North Weald. The plan was to camp along a trail leading to a temple of Hylea. Find my comrades, warn them the Fangs are coming, and help them clear out of the forest. I'll head out first, on my own, to see if I can't lead the Fangs astray and buy us some time. She pulls her estoc a few inches out of its scabbard and cracks a smile. If the gods smile on us, we won't have to draw steel, should it come to that. I'm glad you're on our side. I'm to find the expedition at the North Weald by the side of the path leading to Hylea's temple. Okay, I'm not sure when we'll get to that, but we'll do it. Hurry, the expedition will camp at the North Weald by the ruins next to the Pilgrim's Path. Good luck. Like I said, I'm not sure when we're gonna get to do that. A cool breeze whistles through the leaves. People. With histories. The bed rocks with the gentle swaying of the tree. Actually seems really peaceful, but I'm not sure if I could fall asleep in a place like this. Can I take this stuff? Oh, it says stealing, doesn't it? What's in here? Books. I need these books. You understand? You do not understand, man. Let's send... Durance.
Light, flame, and sound. We'll keep to ourselves.
Yeah. It's going away. I think we can do it in yellow, but I prefer to wait even longer. Cool. There's one more, though. Awesome. I'll read those next episode. Let's check out these guys. Oh, she doesn't say anything. You see a young red-headed boy, almost but not quite a man, stalking the steps of a panther, an ugly curved dagger in his hand. The panther treads lightly, jumping from rock to rock, unconcerned by the danger behind him. He bounds up a tree and turns his green-slit eyes to the child, and you could swear he would be laughing if he could. A flash of black fur, and the panther is gone, and the boy's thoughts littered with curses and self-doubt. The boy moves on, walking for days, hunting for something he never seems to find. He sleeps only in fits, a few hours at a time, before he continues, exhausted and starving. Another day passes, and he kills a rabbit, its huge brown eyes almost entranced as the boy slits its throat from ear to ear and begins to eat it raw. He winces as the tough meat goes down, coagulated blood running down his chin. Covered in drying blood and fatigue, he falls asleep beneath a nearby outcropping of rock, determined to continue the hunt when he awakes. He does not have to wait long. A snuffling in the undergrowth nearby, and his eyes are instantly open, a small hand on his blade. The great black bear sizes him up, almost triple in size, and goes back to foraging. The boy grasps his dagger, knuckles white, and breath in short, nervous gasps. It takes almost a full day before it is done, and he collapses, arm dangling limply from his side. He calls hoarsely, voice feeble. Three men come out from behind the outcropping, swollen with pride. No longer a boy, the young man begins to skin the bear with their help.
Why doesn't this one talk? Reveal your history. We looked at the bed, right? Yeah. Okay, there's another way to go. Check out. There's the monks. We can deliver their stuff. Swaying with the breeze of the tree, same as usual. The monk silently shakes his head, placing a finger over his mouth. The monk shrugs and gestures towards the high monk. I knew they wouldn't talk, so I saved this guy for last. Oh, what about in here? There's no way we could sneak past all these people. They could keep their copper.
Good day to you.
The monk massages his temples, his face buried in his palm. As you approach, he looks up. This room needs a proper door, he mutters. My brothers and I rented this space that we may have some measure of privacy in this foreign land. Perhaps you can find another room here in the inn. What brings your order to this place? We travel where the teachings take us, the monk mutters, his voice slow and measured. Not that it is any of your business. Who are you? Briefly opening his mouth to answer, the monk swallows his words. He looks you up and down, carefully, choosing his response. My brothers and I were having a private discussion in a room we rented for our use. Please, there is a tavern full of people who would provide you with the banter you seek. I met another monk in robes like your own. He died of his wounds right as I found him. The monk's eyes widen, his fists curl in a crackling barrage of popping joints. Robes like ours, you say? Was he carrying anything? Did he tell you anything? Hand you anything? Please, we've been waiting for another of our order to meet us here, and if you found him... All eyes fall to the floor as the monks begin to whisper chants in unison to their fallen friend.
Here. He gave me this missive.
Hand me that, the monk exclaims as he snatches the missive from your grasp. Almost immediately, his face turns red. I mean, please, this is of great importance. Breaking the seals, the monk unrolls the handwritten scroll contained within and quickly reads the message, his lips breathlessly mouthing the text. He turns to address his brothers. My brethren, the arch-martyr has sent word. At long last, we now have what we need. Thank you, stranger, the monk says, folding his hands in front of him as he bows deeply. Your honest soul is to be applauded. I admit I was surprised. When you handed me the message, I expected the seals to be broken. The monk turns red, his face smiling for the first time. I am glad to see common decency is not yet lost from this world. He reaches into the folds of his robes. Here, your honesty must be rewarded. Ooh, we got Isla Braccia added to our inventory. Oh, the minor adventure is completed. Cool. So what was that about exactly? Thank you again for delivering the message. Our brother was wise to entrust you with completing his final mission. Thank you again for delivering the message. What came to mind? And what did we get, and where is it? Let's put some of this crap away. Fuse of vital essence. Where is this thing we got? Potion of Wizard's Double. We can't stack more than one, right? That's why that's there. Okay. Ah, crap. I don't know where this thing is. I don't even know what it is. What's it say? Isla Braccia. What the hell is an Isla Braccia? Is it a book? Oh! It's a small shield. +4 shield deflection. Ranged grazes reflected back at attacker. Cool. The small shield is of lightweight construction, intended to be maneuvered in as swift and dynamic a fashion as its namesake. Despite the fine craftsmanship, it was most famously known as the weapon of a pit fighter who used the shield in the distinctive dance-like fighting style to turn his opponent's attack against them. Am I also using a small shield? I'm using a medium shield. No, I am using a small shield. I think this is better. 8 deflection and +4. Wait. Yeah. Ranged grazes. Yeah, we don't need this. We'll sell it though, thank you. That appears to be it. For the celestial sapling. Okay, stay tuned for next episode when I read these books. These books we got. And, after that, we'll head toward the Passage of the Six for the main event. Well, I'm guessing this will be allowed into at least one of the other districts in the area. Thanks for watching. See you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.